osteophyte stent and make that medial space tight. So the first thing before any kind of soft tissue release is to remove the medial osteophytes. With time, I have come to releasing very little medially, but many times you have to go all the way to the posterior medial corner if you have a tight medial space in extension, which means you may sometimes have to go all the way up to the posterior medial cap, the posterior medial capsule and the posterior oblique ligament. And at the risk of angering Dr. Rajgopal and the other cruciate retainers, I believe that we need to resect the PCL to get equal rectangular extension gap. So we may have to resect the PCL at some point of time. And I'm sure Dr. Rajgopal will not agree, but anyways. Thank you. Okay. All right. And another way, of course, is to downsize the tibial component. So if you're having a tibial component and you see that it's really tight and you've tried all the above methods and you don't know what to do, you can actually downsize it and lateralize it and then remove the excessive medial bump that is there through a reduction osteotomy. Pie crusting is a very good technique, which is actually what most of us started using now, titrating the amount of release we can do. And this is all done after all the cuts are made, after all the releases are made, because you really don't want to touch the superficial MCL at all if possible. And pie crusting, of course, can be done in two techniques, and I won't do that. And really, it's really not essential, but when push comes to shove, you may have to actually somehow recess or release the pest sensitiveness. I would not recommend that. And there is a little role of this medial femoral sliding osteotomy as much as there is of Burden's lateral femoral sliding osteotomy, which I'll tell you about in valgus. But what about flexion? In flexion, it's really, really important to make sure your cuts are right. And that is why using the gap balancing technique and therefore making the flexion cut, not only relying on the major dissection, is the first thing you must do. And it's not just about soft tissue release. Many times, releasing just the anterior fibers of the MCL and the anterior fibers of the pes sensoris tendons are sufficient to give you an equal rectangular flexion gap. And again, you may have to resect the PCL and the posterior medial capsule. This is to be done on the femoral side to get a balanced flexion gap. The thing is, sometimes you may have to do additional bony cuts, but one should not do that and should avoid that unless absolutely necessary. If you've already made the cut and you find that you've tried everything and nothing is working, you may have to actually redo a cut, put the implant in a little bit of a rotation which you're not happy with, and then make alterations on the patellofemoral side as well. So the sequence of release, as I understand it, is to first do an anteromedial capsule and deep MCL release. Make sure the extension gap with spacer blocks or laminar spreaders or tensioning devices, trial implants, whatever. And if you find that, okay, I need to do some soft tissue release, then I would first, because I'm a posterior cruciate substitutor, do a release of the PCL and a posterior medial release extending all the way to the back of the tibia. Mostly, sometimes you may have to go distally as well. If that doesn't work, then I would do a little bit of a superficial pie crusting of the MCL. And again, tighten and see if I've got a rectangular gap in extension. I have not yet needed to do a pes sensorinus resection or release. And I have been lucky not to do a LCL advancement as well, which may be required if you have a very, very lax lateral collateral ligament, as again mentioned by Anup. But what about the valgus? The valgus behaves a little differently. And there are many masters out here who will possibly correct me if I say something wrong. So bear with me when I say this, that in extension balancing, the first thing to do is to remove the additional osteophytes. And that's, again, the first step before any soft tissue release, come what may, whether it's varus deformity or a valgus deformity or a stiff knee or a fixed flexion deformity. And unfortunately, resect the PCL is what I would do in a lateral tight extensor space. And thereafter, continue the release along the posterior lateral corner of the tibia, on the tibial surface, or just behind the tibia, all the way to the posterior border of the iliotibial band. Then talk about either the release, recession, or the pie crusting, or the lengthening of the popliteus tendon. After which, I would talk about pie crusting of all other lateral tight structures. Now, which one to do first, which one to do second, and which one to do later depends upon whether the structures are tight in flexion or extension. But this is what is a general sequence of events that would be followed. And of course, if you're still stuck, you have to revisit your bony cuts. There is a pretty good, well-described osteotomy called the lateral femoral sliding osteotomy, which I have used on a couple of occasions to good effect. For balancing flexion, you need to adjust the femoral rotation correctly. Again, this is based on gap balancing, and if there are, for example, avascular necrosis of the lateral femoral condyle, an old malnutted lateral femoral condyle, you may be misled into believing that that's the correct posterior condyle of the lateral side. So you must make sure that you don't make that mistake. Also make sure you don't have a very lax or very loosened medial collateral ligament, because that will again change your alignment, and then you have to use not just the gap balancing but go back to measure the section while making the cut. Release the PCL and the posterior medial capsule. That's posterior lateral capsule, my mistake. And then you can do the pie crusting of the lateral collateral ligament, the popliteus, and the lateral capsule. Leave the IT band to the last. The IT band is a very, very important dynamic stabilizer, especially in flexion. So make sure you do that last. You may have to do just a pie crusting or a release. And worst case scenario, you may have to release the biceps from the fibular head, in addition to doing the lengthening of the LCL. Again, additional distal femoral or tibial bony cuts can actually change biomechanics, so avoid unless there is no other choice. The sequence of release, as mentioned, again on the lateral side is okay. The first stage is the same on both the sides. You don't do too much of release medially. You release the PCL at the second stage. Posterolateral capsule on the tibial surface of the third stage, and then progressive lengthening of the lateral structures using pie crusting, and if required, do an MCL advancement or reconstruction. So there are different people, or different authors from literature who have chosen different methods to do, and the sequence of releases. As you can see, Insall believes that the posterolateral capsule must be released first, then the lateral collateral ligament, and thereafter the popliteus tendon. Whereas Whiteside says if it's tight in flexion, then it's a different process, and if it's tight in extension, it's a different process. But the sequence of releases is more or less the same depending upon whether you have a tight medial or a tight lateral gap. The idea is to balance it in extension and balance it in flexion. I think we all understand that. So effectively, your knee replacement will be balanced if you have a combination of bony and soft tissue corrections. And you may have to keep titrating them till you get a balanced gap. A very good algorithm used for revision total knees is what sometimes you need to follow, and I'm going to show the algorithm next. And you can use the same algorithm for primary total knees. That is this one. You're all looking for a balanced inflection and balanced extension. That's a perfect situation. But if it's tight inflection and tight in extension, we know that the tibia is contributing, so we need to increase the tibial cut. And if it's a lax inflection and lax in extension, you can get away with a thicker tibial insert. Sometimes you don't have a very good tibial insert because you may end up elevating joint line, so you may actually have to elevate level of the tibia by putting an augment under the tibial implant. But if you have any of the outliers on the opposite diagonal, for example, if it's lax in flexion but tight in extension, then you have to cut more distal femur, or you can upsize the femoral component. The advantage of upsizing the femoral component is you can push the femoral implant down by a few millimeters. But if it's lax in extension, tight in flexion, you have to do the opposite. You have to downsize the femoral component. At the same time, you should not make it tight further in flexion, so you anteriorize the entire distal femur. This basically means you may have some amount of mid-flexion instability. You have to keep that in mind. If it's balanced in flexion, tight in extension, just release the posterior capsule or cut a little bit more distal femur. And if it's lax in extension and balance in flexion, augment the distal femur. So we have two diagonals that you need to keep in mind. The last two options, or the last two scenarios, are also something one must note. If it's tight in flexion, balance in extension, that means you need to downsize and anteriorize so as to increase the posterior space, the femoral component. And again, now the second Tushar Ritana has walked in, so release the PCL and the posterior capsule. And rarely, again, when one talks about increasing the posterior tibial slope, which is really something that you changes your alignment completely. If it's lax in flexion and balance in extension, you can upsize but posteriorize your femoral component. That is the key. to revision, and trust me, it also works in a primary scenario. So the take-home message from this talk really is, in virus, it's mostly the tibial side releases. For the soft tissue release, it's distally, it's medially, and it's posteriorly. Femoral sides releases are usually done much later. Whereas on the valgus, usually the femoral side releases are what probably take precedence, and then you can talk about the tibial side releases. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajiv.